Tonight, Leeza Gibbons is sitting in for Larry King. The topic, beauty that laughs, inside and out. Joining Leeza, a star from the golden days of MGM musicals, actress-entertainer Debbie Reynolds. Another jewel in the MGM crown, and like Debbie, a former Oscar nominee, Janet Leigh. From Rome, the woman who made millions of men say yes to the James Bond movie, Dr. No, Ursula Andress. Back in L.A., one of the silver screen's cool, classically beautiful blondes, Tippi Hedren. And in New York, actress, author, and beauty expert, Arlene Dahl. It's all next on Larry King Live.
Welcome to our rather glamorous pajama party. Thanks for tuning in. I'm Leeza Gibbons, sitting in for Larry King. We've got girl talk tonight of the star-studded variety. What happens when a Hollywood sex symbol, a glamour queen, or a knockout girl next door gets older? Joining us, five remarkable women who've celebrated a lot of birthdays, but still know how to push those beauty buttons. In Los Angeles, the unsinkable Debbie Reynolds. Janet Leigh, who worked with both Alfred Hitchcock and Orson Welles. In Rome, we have Ursula Andress, the original Bond girl, and also with me in Los Angeles, actress and animal protection activist, Tippi Hedren. In New York, one of Hollywood's ravishing redheads and author of numerous beauty books, Arlene Dahl. Welcome, ladies. I can't wait to get into this with you.
Oh, we should have worn pajamas.
We should have. We should have.
A real gag fest, right?
We should have worn very sexy nightgowns and had Larry be here.
Oh, Larry's missing it. Forget it. Larry is missing it wherever you are.
But he had a baby, so he's not missing it, right?
That's true. He's got it all. Youth is a temporary gift. What's that?
I said, I feel like this is more than a pajama party. I think it's an old home week because Debbie and Janet and I used to report at MGM for our films. And of course, I know Ursula in Rome and Tippi from Paramount.
Hello.
So, hello, everybody.
Hi, Arlene. Arlene, hello. I have to say this now because Arlene, I don't know why she ever went into makeup. She would arrive in makeup. We'd arrive looking really grunge. I mean, you know, no hair and, I mean, no hair done and no makeup and jeans or something. She would arrive same time, impeccably dressed, perfection on her face, and I'm saying, why did she even come in? She didn't need to come in.
Full tilt all the time. Well, Arlene, your husband said at one time he never even saw you without makeup.
Well, I don't think he said that. I think the words were put in his mouth, but that's all right.
One of those vicious rumors. Let's talk for a minute, though, about youth. It's a temporary gift. We must all surrender it. And when it fades, when it ripens into middle age, maturity, what happens to you and to us in terms of our emotional sense of who we are and to our marketability, our desirability as women? Tippi, you first.
I don't ever deal with age or any particular age. I never have. I don't think I ever will. I try to stay current with what, you know, the latest fashions are, because I think if you get caught in an age where you think you really looked good and don't progress any further than that, I think that's very aging. But I feel just as young as I did when I was, you know, doing the films and whatever. I refuse to acknowledge it, frankly.
You know what bugs me? It seems to me, Janet, that that older people in general, and women especially, are really marginalized on television and in film. I mean, for instance, we hardly ever see a mature character have a sex life.
Well, it's interesting. I don't know.
And on that note, Janet.
Take that one.
Don't ask me. I mean,
on that note.
I mean, I was married to my present husband at 35, and it was pretty good. So, I mean, I don't know how you define mature. I don't know when maturity, where is the line? I mean, what? I'm like Tippi. I have never addressed age as something that I had to say, oh, it's the 4-0 or the 3-0 or the 5-0 or the 6-0. It doesn't, I never really sort of think about it. I'm so busy thinking and doing other things that I don't have time.
Well, I would say, Arlene, see if you agree, that the standard of beauty has changed. I mean, you know, what 50 looks like now. You know, some directors in town will tell you, good luck if you want to cast a 50-year-old, because most of them simply don't look it.
Well, grandmothers are getting younger every day. I mean, you can be a grandmother at 30 now, you know? I mean, if you start early enough. But I think that age is a matter of attitude. And you have to change with the times. You can't get stuck in the period that you thought you looked the best. That's aging. If
Do you
don't
think...
change your hair, if you don't change your makeup, if you don't change your attitude, and some change their mates.
Ursula, let me ask you. Yes, I think all of us here have done that once or twice. Ursula, let me ask you this, because you, you know, have a European experience and life history. Do you think that we are more youth-obsessed here in America than anywhere else in the world?
You're more youth of...
Obsessed.
I didn't understand the question.
That we're age-phobic here. With staying young, looking young.
I don't know. I really don't know. I don't, everyone else said, I don't have time to think about age. There's so many things to do, and I suddenly find out that I'm 60, and I get shocked by the numbers, because I feel like I'm 20. And I think I better begin to live, because it's gonna be over soon, so I don't really have time to get busy.
It seems that none of you have been limited by your looks at all. I mean, would you say that's fair, Debbie?
Well, I think we all agree that really it's a state of mind. It's a state, it's the way you walk, it's how you think. Well, everything's how we think. But I mean, we stay young because we love life. We're grateful we have it. We don't think of ourselves as old, because it's just like a circle. I mean, we're not kids and climbing up. We are on this side. But we're also terrific.
Yes.
We're funny. We take good care of ourselves. We exercise. We eat right. We honestly, I know Arlene at MGM, and Janet and I are like sisters. And she's very special and a wonderful human being. I think also, let's not forget what all these women do for other people. Everybody here is involved in charity and something for somebody else.
And that's true,
Beauty. Keeps you young.
Let me break away here for a second. We can talk about that. And also, these three ladies with me in LA anyway all have daughters who learned about beauty partly from watching mom. They are all famous. They are all beautiful as well. I want to know generationally, is it different? Is it easier somehow for them? A lot more. We'll be right back after this. Stay close.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Might I ask where you came from?
I fell from the sky. I'm a parachutist and I missed my mark. Where are you going?
Chateau Chantel.
May I use your telephone?
By all means.
Welcome back. Throughout the hour, we'll be seeing some film clips, some of them vintage clips from some of my remarkable guests today. And before the break, we saw Ursula Andress. And it's a good question for any of you, but since that was a ravishing young Ursula, let me ask you, what is it like for you all when you confront your younger selves? When you look at those images,
well,
I mean, you were and are painfully beautiful.
Well, thank you for the compliments, but I'm always shocked when I see myself, because I don't recognize myself. Let's say I hate to look at myself in the mirror, and I never go and see my films. The moment I sometimes see it on the TV, I'm shocked by myself.
Well, we're not.
Why?
You look so beautiful
right now.
Fantastic.
Yeah. It looks super. But it's interesting, because for a lot of people, you are frozen in time. Is there a disconnect with the public between, you know, the myth of perfection and the reality that, you know, our most glamorous stars will age? I mean, some stars, Janet, have gone into hiding because of it.
Well, it's interesting. In my particular case, when you're an ingenue, and if you're a pretty young lady, somehow they never attach talent with that. it's a pretty face and a nice body, you know, and then, of course, when I started, you know, the body had to be there. You couldn't buy it, you know.
You had to get it the hard way.
and so
to earn it.
You had to, you know, be blessed with it. And, and so it was hard, I think, for people to, once they said, oh, this is a pretty young, beautiful face, then they would never sort of acknowledge the fact that there was something there, a depth. And I did probably the three most well-known pictures of my career in my 30s. I mean, Psycho, Manchurian, and Touch of Evil were all, I was 35. You know, 34. Bye-Bye Birdie was 35, 36.
Yeah. But they used to write for us, you know. They took us through the ages. It started us out when we were 16 and 14, like Elizabeth was a little girl of 12, and so, and
right.
They'd write for her, to put her into leading roles when she was only 16, 17. And they'd write for us right up through, like Greer Garson worked until she was in her middle 50s.
Well, that's what the studios gave us, was continuity.
Absolutely.
They gave us continuity.
And that's gone now.
And we could age. It didn't matter. Our audiences loved that.
Well, was it, you know, in the studio system when you were turned out, when you were told what color your hair should be or the arch of your eyebrows and, you know, what to wear and how to stand and all the rest of the things
we heard. That's not true.
I
disagree.
Yeah, I didn't.
I don't think that that's exactly what happened at all. Perhaps in some cases, but when you went into makeup, it depended what kind of a role. If you were playing a 16-year-old naive mountain girl, as I was in the first picture, I didn't wear any makeup because you didn't want any makeup. The reason that I got the role was because I looked that way.
Leeza, aren't you talking about you as Janet Leigh? You're not talking about the roles we played.
No.
You're talking about the star.
Within the system.
Right, but what I'm saying is that the roles dictated the way that you looked.
Well, for the movie, but she's saying as a star.
But as a star, they never told me what to wear or what... I would have to borrow something to wear to an affair because I didn't have the money to buy one.
Yeah. Is it easier for your daughters than for you to compete in an industry that trades on beauty, where that is a commodity, and where sometimes women have to pick, do you go with the beauty or do you go with the brains?
I think it's always been difficult. I think everybody works hard at it. Everybody's always looking for a job. You know, since the studio, the whole thing where you were under contract and you did one film after the other. That was a rather comforting time, I should think. I didn't do that.
That was
I was
wonderful.
Under contract to Hitchcock. And I did the two films with him. And that was wonderful. But now their contracts don't exist any longer.
Mm. You're on your own.
You're always looking for a job.
So it's much more difficult, I think, for our children than it was for today, than it was for us.
Mm-hmm. I want to know, and I know people watching want to know, how do you do it? Beauty that lasts, that is eternal, from the inside out. We'll be right back.
What about the letter you wrote me? Is that a lie, too?
Yeah, I wrote the letter.
What did it say?
It said, "Dear Mr. Brenner, I think you need these lovebirds after all. They may help your personality." That's what it said.
But you tore it up?
Yes.
Why?
Because it seemed stupid and foolish.
Like jumping into a fountain in Rome.
I told you what happened.
You don't expect me to believe that.
Oh, I don't give a damn what you believe.
I'd still like to see you.
Why?
I think it might be fun.
Well, that might have been good enough in Rome, but it's not good enough now.
It is for me.
Well, not for me.
What do you want?
I thought you knew. I want to go through life jumping into fountains naked. Good night. Mr. Brand?
Hmm?
I said, I suppose lots of married folks argue.
Yeah, I suppose they do.
But then I suppose lots of unmarried folks argue, too.
I suppose.
Well, are you going to tell me or not?
Tell you?
If you are, you ain't.
Well, if I are, I ain't what?
Married.
Oh. Ain't.
Oh. Ain't.
Thank you, Leslie.
Leslie Nielsen, very handsome.
That was his first movie.
I asked him. I said, I didn't recognize Leslie.
That's when
me either. Very serious New York actor, and he hated being in that movie, Tammy with a goat, and Walter, Walter Brennan and Debbie Reynolds, who acts crazy, and Walter Brennan, who's funny. And
you were how old?
I was 22.
But you say you don't recognize him. It's you. There is not a better girl next door than Debbie Reynolds, right?
Oh, this is Doris Day and Janet Leigh and Janie Powell and Anne Blythe. You know, when Tippi was saying that she didn't get to be like it's a university at MGM, it was really like a school. And we had Esther Williams said that, and she's right about it. And then we all stayed good friends, too. There was no jealousy of all the girls. You know, Ann Miller and Catherine Grayson.
No
competitiveness. We all love each other.
No.
Well, at that time,
Debbie. That's right. I like to think of it as a finishing school.
Right.
Such fun.
Yes.
Do you think then that it's harder for today's beauties? I mean, Sharon Stone or Melanie Griffith, is it harder for those women?
There's no direction. There's nobody looking after you. The studio system is gone. And I think it's very hard today for an actress. The difference between the days when we were at Metro and now is we used to own our own clothes. We used to wear our own jewelry. It's like Cinderella. They borrow things. Dresses are sent to them from all over the world and jewelry, and they have to give them back at 12 o'clock. I mean, it's not the same. It's not glamorous anymore.
That's why a lot of stars are coming from models. You know, today
that's
the girl,
right.
The models today that are so beautiful, Cindy Crawford, et cetera, are being sought after for films because they are that glamour. But we have some wonderful girls. You know, Sharon Stone is quite beautiful. Your daughter's a killer. Melanie, you know. Mm-hmm.
What do you think Melanie learned about beauty, Tippi, from watching you?
Well, Melanie is a very, very independent woman. She always has been.
Aren't they all?
I mean, aren't they all?
Jamie Leigh, I know, is
you know,
too.
I mean, I think a lot of it, you know, rubs off from what your parents do, from what your mother does, and you watch. I used to sit with Melanie, and we'd both put on makeup. You know, this little tiny little postage stamp face of hers, and we'd put makeup on together when she was very, very tiny.
I remember reading when she. Was in Lolita, the remake of Lolita, mm-hmm. and she played mm-hmm. the mom.
Yes.
She said it was kind of an adjustment for her ego, and that if she could take her head and put it on a 20-year-old body at that time, she would. I don't know why, because she has a perfect body.
But she has a perfect body.
Would you ever go back, any of you? Debbie, if you could, would you go back?
Go back to having a perfect body?
To 20 years old.
Oh, no, it's silly to even talk about it. You don't want to go back because you really like what you know now, right, girls?
Oh, absolutely. Oh, yeah.
I do like, I really feel that God has been good to me. My life has been wild and crazy and miserable at times, but I've learned a great deal.
But that's life.
Well, that is life.
Why don't we value it? I mean, Arlene, why don't we, we're growing into being the elder members of the tribe, and there should be an awful lot of respect and stature that comes with that, and it seems that in our country, it's not valued like it should be.
Well, I think it's important for a woman to mature and contribute to life. I think that keeps her young, keeps her mind going, it keeps her spirit involved. And of course, I have three children. My oldest son is Lorenzo Lamas. He's working all the time. My daughter is with CNN right now doing special projects. My youngest son is a sculptor. And I have seven grandchildren. And that keeps me very busy, plus which I'm working with the Pearl Buck Foundation to raise funds for Amerasian children. And I'm working on bringing the Broadway Walk of Stars to fruition with the city of New York. So I keep busy. I'm also working on three books right now. And I write an astrology column. So I don't get time to get bored. And I'm married to a man who's 18 years younger, so that's a challenge.
You go, girl. We'll be right back. Give me a couple minutes.
Stand on your chair, for things are humming.
the beauty bar, if you want to call it that, seems to be raised higher and higher, and my guests tonight are all women who continue to reach that standard. But when you look at how we view beauty in our culture, how do you define it? Who defined it for you? I mean, who was the standard of beauty for you growing up, Debbie?
Well, Debbie loved all the musicals. As far as films were concerned, it wasn't about beauty. It was about dancing and music, and that movie took me somewhere. We were very poor. Most of us were poor. And it took you somewhere. It made you say, that's wonderful. I can have that life. Maybe even if you didn't go there, you just felt so good when you go to the films. It would cost a dime, and you'd work hard to earn that money. So beauty wasn't it for me. It was the talent, you know. It was Betty Hutton. I mean, was not known as a beauty. She was my favorite. Judy Garland. I loved Judy. Well, not again known as the beauty.
I echo that completely. For me, the beauty was what I felt from what I was getting on the screen, whether it was a dance number, whether it was an emotional pull at my heart, and the imagination of living all those characters, not thinking of being up there, but just the fact of being taken to all those places, and you became Madame Curie, and you were, you know, Marie Antoinette, and you were everybody that you'd ever read about or thought about, and so really I never thought about beauty. I thought about what it said to me.
Well, and they looked beautiful, so it wasn't about us ever striving to be beautiful.
It was what they did and what message they sent.
But isn't it a shame that it seems that we exist within an industry where image is more important than substance, and women of a certain age, that coy euphemism for being over 40, are just not given the opportunities?
You know, but the beauty and how you look, you can make, you know, a good impression. But if you don't do anything other than be a pretty face or whatever, there, that gets to be very boring. And I should think it would be very boring to just be a pretty face, you know, without having anything to do that's meaningful, that's important.
It's interesting because people say, well, aren't you glad you're not doing those silly ingenue roles anymore? And I say to them, no, I don't consider them silly at all. I was 18. What am I supposed to do? I couldn't play psycho at 18. And I couldn't at the age then play Rosie Ridge. I mean, you know, it just, you play what your age is.
You grow up.
You grow up and mature.
Well, that's what the writers did do for us.
And the one thing I'm saying to you, to tell Carrie, I do it in my novels. In both of my novels, there are great roles for mature women. Okay?
There you go.
And tell Carrie you do the same thing.
Okay.
I've got to break away, but Tippi, I heard recently that there was a role that you were up for that you did not get. And I want to share with the audience why you were passed over when we come back. We are back. I'm Leeza Gibbons. I'm filling in for Larry King, and we're continuing our discussion about beauty that stands the test of time, inside and out. Joining us, five women who obviously know a lot about slowing down the clock. With me in L.A., Debbie Reynolds. This lady keeps a schedule that would exhaust a kid. Another Oscar-nominated actress, Janet Leigh. She has said, by the way, it's true, Psycho did put her off showers for life. In Rome, we have Ursula Andress, who walked out of the sea in Dr. No and into millions of men's fantasies. And again in L.A., Tippi Hedren, she's gone from starring in The Birds to saving big cats. And in New York, a longtime inspiration for the glamour-impaired Arlene Dahl. So, Tippi, you were up for a role, I understand, as a grandmother?
No, I was up for a role as a mother.
As a mom?
As the mother to Jacqueline Kennedy. And they said, I look too young. And I thought, well, you know, these are movies. Why can't they make me look the way I should, or supposedly what they have in their mind? But apparently that's very difficult for some people to do, which is amazing to me.
But see, is it true? Remember Goldie's character in First Wives, where she said there are three ages for women. It's Babe, District Attorney, Driving Miss Daisy. I mean, what you're saying is, it sounds like that's kind of true.
Mm-hmm. And it's very frustrating.
It must be.
It's extremely frustrating.
I find that sometimes people don't really want to acknowledge how old you are, because then that has to make them acknowledge how old they are, because you've been around in the business as long as they have. So if they know that I'm 72, they say, 72, that makes me 75. Well, she's not 72. No.
But see, you just put it out there. I'm 72. You have no issue with it.
I have no issue. I tell you, this is a true story that I know of an actress who lied about her age. This is true. Lied about her age. The reporter who asked her knew exactly how old she was. It's in the records. You don't have to, you know, it's not any big deal. And, but she lied. And so to punish her, he added years to when he did the story, he added years to her. Boy, I never lied about that. And when you say you try to look good, I'd rather somebody say, God, she looks good for 72, rather than somebody saying, oh my God, she looks terrible for 60.
Well, I loved Melanie's campaign for Revlon, I guess it was, a don't lie about your age, defy it.
But you know what, Melanie did David Letterman one right night. And David Letterman has a tough time talking to her. I mean, he really has a difficult time.
He's looking at her tits.
But he said, Melanie, how old are you? And she said, I just hate it when people ask me. He said, my mom just hates it, you know, when I tell how old I am. She said, I don't know what she was so worried about. She had me when she was 12. So forget about it. Which is very funny. Of course, by that time, the whole issue was over, and he went on to talk about other things, which I find is the best way to handle when somebody asks me how old I am. You
know, just move on.
Just make up some story.
Leeza, may I make a comment on age?
Please.
When I interviewed Coco Chanel for my book many years ago, she said to me, she said, you know, a woman who will tell her age will tell you anything. So with Debbie and Janet and I, we had to have our contracts okayed when we were 18 because we couldn't get our money, all of it, until we were 21. So our age is a matter of record. No, so we can't, I'm 72, Janet's 72, Debbie was younger than we were, but you can't lie about your age. And why? Every day should be a celebration.
Exactly. Here.
Because the alternative is not something I want to consider right there, now.
And that is
a top-gun
salute.
Agree.
That is true beauty. We'll be right back. Stay close if you can.
Okay, George. I didn't want to hurt you, but you're asking for it. Last Christmas, just 3 months ago, you were in San Moritz with a model from Harper's, Elsa Underwood. You were crazy about her. You even talked of getting married. But she got a telegram from Dick Avedon and had to rush back to Paris for retakes.
Dick Avedon, my foot. That telegram was a phony. She came back to meet some guy, and they were shacked up in some hotel.
The Ritz, George, in a suite overlooking the Place Vendôme. It was me, George. I'm sorry.
You dirty rat. I should have known.
She was no good, George.
And my good friend Charlie Sorrell's got to be the one to prove it to me, right?
Yeah, you were getting serious
you
about her. I couldn't let
you.
I did it for you, George.
Me?
My word of honor.
Ah, Charlie Sorrell's word of honor.
You could have been badly hurt, George, and I
That's
didn't want
enough,
to
Charlie.
Much.
Drop it.
Have I come to the right room this time?
Yes. Countess.
Herr Leutnant. May I offer my congratulations?
You may. Can I get you a drink?
Please.
I hope you'll be able to be there tomorrow.
Of course. I want to... No, I won't do it. No, please. I want to talk to you.
Talk?
Please.
All right. Talk.
Gorgeous. Ursula Andress, brought to the U.S. as the new Dietrich. I can imagine there must have been a tremendous amount of pressure on you, was there?
Well, you know, I was under contract to Paramount, and they wanted to make me into somebody which I was not. So I got so scared and rebelled, so they threw me out of the studio, because I never went to school, I never went to the diction or to the English, to acting school, because I was so scared, because they thought I'm gonna be something incredible, and I couldn't live up to it, so I just ran away.
You said at the beginning...
It was too hard on me.
I can imagine. You said at the beginning of the hour that you didn't see what the rest of us see when you look in the mirror. Do you not feel that you look sexy?
Because
the three of us were talking
sexy.
About it.
It's a word that gives me, like, I don't know. I don't like the expression, and for myself, not at all. No.
But
I like myself more. Pardon me.
When you look at, for instance, the spreads you did for Playboy. You look at those pictures. You have to appreciate the sheer beauty of that body.
Well, my ex-husband took those photographs, and I have no problem with nudity. Let's say I can look at myself. I'm walking around nude. It doesn't bother me. I see other people walking around nude. It doesn't bother me. But I don't use my body to seduce. No, I don't think so. I just stand there.
What if Playboy said to you now, "We want you to do a nude spread"?
Oh, please.
What, Janet says, "Oh, please." Oh, please.
Well,
why?
No. My God, my God, no, 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 no. She offered me one about 10 years ago, and I said, no, I can't do it, no. I'm happy to cover up now.
Now, why is that such an absurd idea, ladies?
Well, I think that with maturity, you also have a responsibility, because at my point, I've never thought that showing everything was the most exciting.
Sexual.
I have always found more interest in something that made me use my imagination.
A little mystery.
A little mystery there. And so I wouldn't have done it, you know, even in when I was young.
Now, Janet has size. Oh, yeah.
I don't mind. I mean, you know, that's fine. I'm happy to stick them out there, but I'm just saying to...
Salute!
Yeah, and fine. And I got a lot of salutes, but...
they're anyway, all serving them up here
we're
in the
all
studio.
Just terrible now. But what I'm saying is that I don't think that just bearing all, and I'm not putting anything down, anybody who does it, that's fine. That's just my take on it, that's all. So I wouldn't have done it before, and I certainly wouldn't do it now.
Well, nobody did. Harlow didn't do it. Lombard didn't do it. Nobody.
No,
they
no.
were as sexual as anybody could ever be. Always a piece of chiffon or coming out behind the curtain.
Something
it's
that
like the hidden treasure.
Excuse the word, but titillate.
Mm. Oh, well, we'll excuse
it's a good
the word.
Word.
No, but it is. Yeah. That's what you want to do when...
Yes, Arlene.
Leeza, I'd just like to say something. Janet mentioned the mystery, and I think a woman who loses her mystery loses a lot. A man doesn't want to know it all unless she's his woman, and then he can have it all. But I think if she shows it to everyone, they won't care anymore. So a woman should always keep a mystery about her.
Yeah. Yes,
it's never show it all.
To be very, very special and have that, I think people who kind of flaunt all of it are, I don't find that very interesting.
Are you offended by the level of skin that you see? I mean, for instance, at all the award shows, it's like cut to here and down to here.
Yeah, it's... it's just, I think, just unattractive.
With that.
It's not
that
I'm offended.
They don't really need to do it.
It isn't necessary.
Tell me the secrets, ladies, and anybody jump in. We'll get to New York and Rome as well. What do you do, Debbie?
Crisscross maiden form bra.
Oh, what is this?
I mean,
Jane Russell says it's her crisscross maiden form bra that keeps... So, What is
no,
the secret?
I mean, there's no like
I'm not. I was never known as this, you know, the sexual. So you should really talk.
But look how
Ursula Andress is just the beauty.
To your youth and your beauty and your energy and your vitality, what do?
Well, I try to retain all of that by being an interesting person, by studying. I've always studied, and all the girls here have said that. We never give stop your brains because, you know, it's one thing that we should all be interesting and as sexual as one God gave you for that. Everybody has a different libido about it. You know, I myself make such poor choices in husbands that I'm always available. So I'm not the person to talk to about men anyway, because it's just horrendously frightening. But as far as desiring to be good looking and interesting and wear really pretty clothes and keep your figure right and have a nice body that men would enjoy just looking at. I mean, I think we all care about how we look very, very much.
Well, I think it's the fact of being alive. I mean, I am busier now than I was when I was younger. I used to have time to read for pleasure. Now I have to read for research to write my books. I travel more than I ever did. I don't know, but I don't have time to sit down and barely read the paper.
Right.
Stand by. I'm Leeza Gibbons sitting in for Larry King, and we'll be right back.
That good wine.
At the police station, they told me you had just beaten up a very large Chinese gentleman.
Not Chinese, Korean. At least I think he was Korean.
A very large Korean gentleman. But that you were a pretty solid type yourself, according to Washington, with whom they had apparently checked. So I figured if they were willing to go to all the trouble to get a comment on you out of George Washington, why, you must be somebody very important indeed. And I must say it was rather sweet of the general with you only a major. I didn't even know you knew him. If they were the tiniest bit puzzled about you, they could have asked me. Oh, yes, indeed, my darling Ben. They could have asked me, and I would have told them.
I've got five beautiful women as my guests tonight, but all of you have rich, fulfilling lives where you don't depend on your beauty to sustain who you are. Arlene, do you find that beautiful women, though, are not taken as seriously? In youth,
well,
let's
say. Well, that used to be, of course, if you did certain roles and you wore these clothes and you looked beautiful on the screen and it took a whole department to put you out there to make you look beautiful, then you weren't supposed to be able to act. And I had to go back to the theater to find roles that I could act in. And I love beautiful clothes. God knows, every woman I know loves to look her best and loves beautiful clothes. But if you're an actress, I think you need to explore the different facets of a woman, all ages.
I look at women like Susan Sarandon, for instance, who has managed to continue to work and get meaningful roles. I mean, Meryl Streep, of course. But they're few and far between. Is it because there are men making the decisions and they have some male adolescent fantasy of what a woman should be or look like?
Well, men always ran the industry, so I don't think that's changed. They always did before.
There's some powerful women coming into the industry.
Oh, there are. Sherry Lansing, you have some wonderful.
Absolutely.
But the performers today find their own product. The girls find their own. Sally Fields and Goldie Hawn, Bette Midler, they buy their own books, they buy their own projects in order to stay right current with their age and be wonderfully gifted, which they are.
Also, there's a difference in product. I mean, Boys Don't Cry would never have been made when we were younger.
Right.
And so that you know, there's a different... there's a larger arena now where women can be taken as an actress and not just looks. And when we started, it's almost like you had to wait until you were 29 and 30 and 35 before, you know, they would take you seriously as a dramatic actress.
Mm-hmm. Today they can be beautiful. Michelle Pfeiffer is a wonderful actress.
Right, but you can also, you don't have to be beautiful. I mean, Hilary Swank is beautiful, but she certainly isn't your
typical
it's a different kind of beauty. Mm-hmm. And and the role would never have been made. You weren't allowed to make those any kind of realistic or different, something different. Whereas today, young people get a chance to do that much more than we ever did.
I want to ask you, I mean, they're telling me I've got to break away again, but now we know so much more about stars. You know, there's so much more available about them, and you talk about mystery. It's been a complete unveiling. Does that help or hurt? We'll be right back.
Both.
Jerry, I have a confession to make. I fell in love today.
How's that?
I fell in love today. Desperately.
Oh, with that young Mr. Andress?
No. With New York. Oh, Jerry, this is the most fabulous, exciting, thrilling city. Oh, we just have to be here. Oh, this is where all the most important people in the world are.
Carol, could it be that you're just a bit of a social climber?
Well, if I am, then New York is Mount Everest.
Suppose it doesn't work out.
It just has to.
I wonder what would happen if you had to make a choice between New York and me.
Oh, darling, as if there could be any choice. Why can't I have you both?
I've got just a couple of minutes. I want to get final comments and find out what everybody is up to now. Debbie?
Well, I'm on the road working theaters, one-nighters everywhere, Hilton, Atlantic City, and Westbury, Long Island. Janet?
I have a picture coming out called Fate Totally Worse Than Death. I have my fourth book coming out called House of Secrets, a good role for us. And young, I'm not prejudiced.
Okay, what?
And
mix it up.
Yeah, and I'm planning a TV special as well.
Tippi, I know you're saving the world as always.
I'm saving the world. I'm saving a lot of animals. And I'm working on a bill, which I've been working on for 4 years, called the Shambhala Wild Animal Protection Act, which is hopefully going to be dropped in the House and the Senate in this session, with Tom Lantos as sponsoring on the House, and John McCain on the Senate side, and of course, as director of the Shambhala Preserve. And I've got a film coming out called Storytellers. And I'm working on film preservation with American Movie Classics. Yes. Janet's doing that,
too. They are busier than ever.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's craziness.
Arlene, another book for you?
Yes, my 15th beauty book I'm working on. It's called Lasting Beauty for the Woman Over 40 to 90 to 100. And my autobiography, finally.
Finally. Oh. Ursula, first of all, bless your buns. It's like 3 a.m. in Rome while we're doing this.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Yes, what are you doing? What are your plans?
My plans are, I live here in Italy, and I'm going to go to bed soon. I visit my family in Switzerland. I'm waiting for my son to come back from Africa, where he does some voluntary work. And I take care of my flowers and my cats, and that's living.
Boy, it's such a different life, isn't it?
And enjoy food.
And she enjoys food. Someone who's going to admit it with us. Good deal. I have had a lovely time. It's not just your physical beauty, but it's your passion, your intelligence, your commitment as moms, and your ability to navigate yourself to this stage in life and continue to be fresh and reinvent. And that's what it's all about, I guess, isn't it?
And how about you? What are you doing?
Yes.
Thank you all, ladies, so much. I have certainly enjoyed it. Thank you, Larry, for loaning me the chair for tonight.
Yeah,
take good care.
Larry.
Good night.